Welcome and good evening. My name is Samir Gandesha. I'm an associate professor here at SFU in the Department of Humanities. I'm also the director of the Institute for the Humanities, which, along with SFU's Van City Office for Community Engagement, the Peter Allard School of Law at UBC, the BCCLA, and CIRAT is co-sponsoring and hosting this evening's event, which, as you know, is an expert panel discussion of Bill C-51, which is currently before the Public Safety Committee in the House of Commons. Before I go any further, I'd like to acknowledge our territorial hosts this evening, the Musqueam, Tsleil-Waututh, and Squamish peoples. We're extremely fortunate this evening to have a truly stellar panel of experts with us tonight. In order of participation, we have Professor Max Cameron to my immediate right, Professor Craig Forcese, who will join us via Skype, as you can see on the screen behind me, Ms. Micheal Vonn from the BCCLA, and Professor Margot Young, who you've just heard come in via audio. She is, as you know now, on holiday with her family, spring break vacation in Hawaii. And we have also Mr. Zool Suleman with us this evening. So I'll try to keep my remarks brief in the interest of time so we can move the discussion along and really get to, I think, a crucial question and answer session. I'm sure many of you want to ask questions and make comments. So this panel falls squarely within the Institute's mission, which is to address the fundamental social, political, economic, religious, and in this case, legal questions of our time through the tradition of the humanities broadly understood. Typically, we organize our events months in advance. However, occasionally, in exceptional circumstances, we are compelled to respond on the fly. And this is one of those occasions. A previous instance of responding very quickly, you know, within a matter of weeks, to events as they unfolded, was in the aftermath of the cartoon controversy in Denmark several years ago, in a panel that also included a representative from the BCCLA, various faith communities, and was moderated by Vancouver Sun's religion writer Douglas Todd. The Institute provided at the time much needed context for dispassionate, reasonable discussion and debate on the justifiable limits to free expression, a question that has lost nothing of its urgency in recent years and months, one could say. Obviously, we're hoping for the same kind of reasonable, informed discussion this evening. One thing that you will notice is conspicuously absent, at least in direct form, from this panel, is the impact or potential impact of Bill C-51 on Indigenous communities. The reason why we didn't address it directly is because the multiple impacts on First Nations is really so complex and important that it would really require a separate panel of its own. And indeed, the nature of this panel as it came together was very much last minute fly by the seat of one's pants. I will note, however, that the Grand Chief, Stuart Phillip, who recently just testified before the Public Safety Committee in the House, will be participating in our conference on the state of extraction, which will happen this Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. And there's information that that you can find out, you can receive about that in the room. We're also hoping to host Professor Pam Palmiter in 2015, 2016, and she also recently gave testimony before the committee. So before I go on to speak about the format for the panel, I'd just like to say a few things by way of introduction. In the immediate aftermath of the election of the Conservative majority government in 2011, the Institute sponsored a panel on its likely implications and ramifications. It featured UBC's Michael Byers, the editor of the Taii David Beers, and Open Media's Riley Yeo. On the panel, there was more or less a consensus around a thesis first articulated, I think, by Lawrence Martin, that the Tories under Harper were likely to use their majority to transform not simply the substance of the Canadian state, but that would do so in ways that would make these changes irreversible, in the way that Thatcherism was able to institutionalize itself in the UK after the demise of Thatcher in the 1990s. Indeed, what Thatcher said as to her greatest accomplishment in the several years of power that she enjoyed was New Labour. That was her accomplishment, because the terms of political debate and the institutional forms of the British state had been irreversibly transformed. Now, I don't think anyone on that panel, any one of us on that panel, could have predicted the extent to which this could be true, the extent to which this government has indeed made Canada unrecognizable, as Stephen Harper once promised. The current legislation under discussion tonight is just one, albeit a particularly troubling dimension, of this fundamental transformation of Canadian institutions. These developments ought not to be seen, however, as an exclusively Canadian phenomenon, but rather could be understood, according to political philosophers such as Giorgio Agamben, to be part of a discernible trend towards the arrogation on the part of the executive branch of liberal democracies of more power to itself at the expense of legislative and judicial branches, a trend that Agamben sees intensifying in the period after the First World War, which entails the executive's increasing propensity to declare a state of exception in order to essentially rule by decree. He argues that such states of exception are often declared not simply in relation to military, but also economic exigencies. Such a propensity is only intensified since September 11th, 2001, particularly in the United States, with the passing of the Patriot Act, the creation of a Department of Homeland Security, the use of Guantanamo Bay as a zone that is excluded from the normal operations of international law, for example, the Geneva Convention governing the treatment of prisoners of war, and domestic espionage and surveillance activities of the NSA, as documented by Glenn Greenwald, and extrajudicial kill lists signed off by the president. One also thinks about the recent use of secret detention facility in Chicago at Homeland Square, where habeas corpus was temporarily suspended, the ominous equivalent of CIA black sites, as The Guardian reports. Well, I don't think we've reached that stage. I don't think we've necessarily reached the stage where a Princeton University study could claim that the United States is technically no longer a democracy. We seem to be headed in a very dangerous direction indeed. In fact, the universally respected former Auditor General Sheila Fraser claims that the Harper government has, quote, turned Canadian democracy into a charade. One can point to a larger trend here, as comprehensively documented by Michael Harris in his 2014 book, Party of One, Stephen Harper and Canada's Radical Makeover. And this trend would consist of such developments as the following: the centralization of power in the PMO, the Prime Minister's office, the use of prorogation to enable the government to avoid parliamentary debate on serious matters such as the treatment of prisoners in Afghanistan in the lead up to the 2010 Olympic Games, the use of omnibus budget bills such as Bill C-38 to pass legislation very far removed from budgetary matters, legislation with far-reaching implications, as we know, for the environment, the muzzling of federal government scientists and librarians, particularly as their work may pertain to climate change, the use of cabinet-appointed boards, such as the NEB, to avoid what many consider to be the necessary rudiments of meaningful, transparent, and evidence-based consultations with stakeholders, the clashing with the Supreme Court over the proposed nomination of Judge Marc Nardon to the Supreme Court of Canada, the passage of the Fair Elections Act, which effectively limits electoral participation. One could go on, but I won't. Bill C-51 could certainly be seen to represent an excellent example of the overreach of executive power, I will go into detail neither about the process by which this and other legislation makes its way through Parliament under the current government, neither about the specific provisions of the legislation for which I lack the necessary expertise, and this is why we have our distinguished panel this evening. I will say, however, that if the bill is passed, it would fundamentally remake the security architecture of the Canadian state. The proposed legislation consists of five parts. The first two would constitute enactments of the Security of Canada Information Sharing and the Secure Travel Acts. And the following three provide amendments to the Criminal Code, the Canadian Security Intelligence Service, and the Immigration and Refugee Protection Acts. The most worrying part, it would seem, as Professor Forcese and his colleague Kent Roach pointed out in their widely cited essay on C-51, in the Walrus, is that it would provide for so-called kinetic powers for CSIS, or the ability of the agent not just to engage in information gathering, but to actually intervene in the world with fairly broad scope, with no new powers or funding granted to the overseeing board, CERC. It would, moreover, empower CSIS to ask the Supreme Court of Canada to suspend provisions of the Charter of Rights and Freedoms. It also provides for a broader definition of what terrorism may or may not entail. For example, anything that may undermine Canada's national interest, for example, such as peaceful civil disobedience actions, or peaceful disobedience actions that aim to stop the creation of an oil pipeline, or the assertion of Indigenous sovereignty. The legislation is being criticized not by the usual suspects of the left liberal academics and journalists, but also by the Canadian Bar Association, which is coming out with a very detailed report, I think, tomorrow. And indeed, four former prime ministers and five former Supreme Court justices have expressed deep concerns about the various implications of the bill. I'm sure our panelists tonight will have much to contribute to what is an ongoing, nonpartisan, yet critical discussion of this proposed legislation. So a brief note now about format. We'll begin with Professor Cameron, who will discuss the procedural issues that attend the bill's journey through the House of Commons. We'll then hear from Professors Craig Forcese, who's behind me, Ms. Micheal Vonn here to the right of Professor Cameron, and then Professor Margot Young via audio feed, and they will discuss the specific provisions of the legislation itself, so really getting into the legislation, the proposed legislation, and discussing it in some detail. And then finally, Zool Suleman will discuss the implications of the legislation for Muslim communities and for immigrants in this country. Each speaker will speak for no more than 12 minutes. I've warned them that I'll be gentle yet firm in holding them to this. Again, in the interest of a fulsome discussion at the end, this is something that's really important. I should also note that this panel is currently being filmed and also webcast, and I believe that our colleagues at the Selkirk College in Nelson have organized a special event to watch it and have a discussion there. So welcome Selkirk College students, faculty, and general public from the Nelson area. One last note, I'd like to express my deep gratitude to all of the participants tonight to participate on this panel, literally at the drop of a hat. They've been extremely accommodating, extremely wonderful to work with, at least so far. A special thanks also to Margot Young, who's enjoying her vacation in Hawaii. And also my good friend Am Johal, who's over there in the audience, for providing particularly helpful support and assistance in getting this panel organized. And as always, a very special thank you as well to Ms. Huyen Pham, the program assistant of the Institute, for all of the tremendous work she does. Now where she is. Okay, so now without any further ado, it gives me tremendous pleasure to introduce our first speaker, Professor Max Cameron. Max Cameron specializes in comparative politics, focusing in particular in Latin America, constitutionalism, democracy, and political economy. He has published widely on democracy in Latin America and co-authored The Making of NAFTA, How the Deal Was Done. His most recent book is Strong Constitutions, Social Cognitive Origins of the Separation of Powers. Cameron has taught at Carleton in Yale, at Carleton University, Yale University, and the Colegio de Mexico. Since 2011, he has served as a director of the Center for the Study of Democratic Institutions, and in 2013, Cameron won a UBC Killam Teaching Prize. Cameron is currently working on a book entitled Between Rules and Practice, Why We Need Practical Wisdom in Politics. Please welcome Professor Max Cameron.
Thank you very much. I think if we've been cooperative and pleased to join this event at the drop of a hat, it is because it's such an important event. And I want to thank you, Samir, for organizing it and for inviting us all to come together to talk about this important legislation. As Samir mentioned, my work focuses on constitutionalism and the separation of powers. And so it'll be from that perspective that I will look at this legislation. I believe that Bill C-51 threatens the very foundation of our legal system. Excuse me. It weakens the rule of law and the separation of powers, which underpins our democracy. It'll make our political institutions not only less democratic, less robust in their capacity to guarantee our fundamental rights and freedoms, but it will also weaken our capacity to respond to the threats that we face, and weaken our capacity to mobilize the resources that we need to act collectively to achieve the public good. Our political system is based on the concept of the rule of law. And what that means is that nobody is above the law. All actions by citizens and governments alike must comply with the law. And no one person should be the judge of their own cause. Whenever the rules are made by the same person or group of people that implements and enforces those rules, we find ourselves in the very definition of tyranny. 800 years ago, the tyrant King John was forced to sign the Magna Carta, which affirmed, "No free man shall be seized or imprisoned, or stripped of his rights or possessions, or outlawed or exiled, or deprived of his standing in any way, nor will we proceed with force against him or send others to do so, except by the lawful judgment of his equals or by the law of the land." Bill C-51 amends the Canadian Security Intelligence Act to allow CSIS, our intelligence system, to respond to threats to Canada's security by means of measures that contravene fundamental rights and freedoms guaranteed in our Charter of Rights and Freedoms. And it also allows CSIS to break Canadian law. That is, the Charter explicitly authorizes lawbreaking and violations of the Charter by our intelligence service. What would the barons at Runnymede have thought of the idea of judge-issued warrants to enter any place, and I'm quoting the bill, or open or obtain access to anything, remove or make copies, or record any information, record or document, or install, maintain, or remove anything? Such sweeping powers were precisely their target. Such abrogations of the law and the Constitution are, in this legislation, given the fig leaf of legality, which really only makes matters more obnoxious. Lawbreaking is to be authorized by a warrant from a judge, except that the judge may not authorize specific illegal activities that are exempted. CSIS shall not cause death or bodily harm, shall not obstruct or pervert the course of justice, and shall not violate the sexual integrity of an individual. So what's wrong with this? What's wrong is we cannot put a judge in a position of saying, The law says that you must do X, but notwithstanding that, you have my permission to do Y. Permission on what basis? On what grounds? When a judge issues a warrant, it is to guarantee, and the word warrant, the etymology of the word warrant, comes from guarantee, to guarantee the legality of the actions of the police. It is not to find exceptions. It is not to exercise discretion with respect to what the law is or says. As Paul Ricoeur puts it, the most fundamental limitation juridical argumentation meets has to do with the fact that the judge is not a legislator, that he applies the law, that is, he incorporates into his arguments the law in effect. It is the job of the judge, strictly speaking, to say what the law is, neither more nor less. The very idea that a judge might counsel an illegal act is inimical to our rule of law tradition and strikes at the very heart of our system of justice. These provisions, furthermore, undermine the very principle of the hierarchy of laws. What this principle requires is that when a higher law comes into conflict with a lower law, the higher law prevails. Constitutional provisions cannot be overturned by statutory law. Statutory laws cannot be abrogated by municipal ordinances, and a contract among individuals can't be used to ignore municipal ordinances. But Bill C-51 uses statutory law to interpret what guarantees the Charter of Rights and Freedoms can or cannot be abrogated by a judge. It essentially creates two classes of constitutional guarantees: those that can be abrogated by a judge and those that cannot. And it does so in legislation that ranks below the Constitution. Who gave the Parliament of Canada the right to reinterpret our Constitution and to decide that there are two tiers of guarantees? To reinterpret the Constitution through ordinary legislation makes nonsense of our legal system and our Constitution. And it makes nonsense of the separation of powers. I'm delighted that we're joined by Craig Forcese, and his work with Kent Roach, I think, has been a superb example of engaged scholarship. And they say, for the first time, judges are being asked to bless in advance a violation of our charter rights in a secret hearing, not subject to appeal, and with only the government side represented. The Canadian Bar Association will be arguing tomorrow that this legislation brings the entire charter into risk and is unprecedented in our law. And I'm also delighted that we're joined by the BC Civil Liberties Association, who have argued that the role of the court in our constitutional system is to ensure that both the executive and the legislature act in accordance with the law. To ask the court to authorize constitutional violations is simply offensive to the rule of law. The separation of powers requires only this: that legislatures legislate, judges judge, and executives execute policy. And there's a purpose to organizing the state in this manner. It's because no law, no matter how carefully written, is unambiguous or free from multiple interpretations. A term like terrorism, what does it mean? We have an extremely broad definition of terrorism in our current legislation. And I know this because I've been working over the past few years trying to defend a former member of the Farabundo Martí Liberation Front, the FMLN, José Figueroa, who lives in Langley, who is currently in sanctuary because he has an order for deportation by the Canadian Border Services Agency, because as a student, he was an organizer with the FMLN in El Salvador. That organization, which is the democratically elected government of El Salvador today, is deemed by the government a terrorist organization, even though he committed no act. There's never been any question of him committing any act of violence whatsoever, let alone an act of terrorist violence. The ANC, under our legislation, is a terrorist organization, and yet we've given a passport, or we gave a passport to Nelson Mandela. There are, if you have a broad, expansive definition of terrorism, you need extraordinary nuance and good judgment to apply that to particular cases. And you don't achieve this through sweeping legislation and then leaving it up to administrative agencies to decide how best to implement that legislation. You need to build in checks and balances, not to hinder the functioning of government as a whole, but to guarantee its consistency and to ensure that the actions of government officials are deliberate, implemented effectively, and enforced impartially. And the best way to do this is by creating branches of government that are specialized in their distinctive activities and that work together to generate authoritative interpretations that guide collective action in accordance with the public interest. The sad truth is that our parliament in Canada has been emasculated to such degree that it is no longer a meaningful deliberative body. We have omnibus bills that are so complex and comprehensive that their effects can hardly be understood by the MPs who pass them. These bills are rushed through committees that no longer do meaningful work, passed without amendments, and passed after closure cuts off debate. Among the weaknesses of our parliamentary system is a lack of parliamentary oversight of our intelligence service. Such oversight is absolutely necessary to ensure the implementation and the enforcement of the law, and that it's to ensure that the actions of government are compatible with the rule of law and the public interest. Many people will object to Bill C-51 because they fear that it enhances state power at the expense of the citizen. And that is a real danger. My objection, however, is to the way that the bill actually weakens our political institutions. It'll do this not only by making them vulnerable to the abuse of power and with that the loss of legitimacy that inevitably follows, and it'll do it by making it harder to mobilize the resources in our society that enable effective collective action in response to threats. It's going to create confusion over what the intelligence agencies can and cannot do, over what constitutes legitimate dissent, over the role of the courts, and over the functions of our legislative institutions. So it pains me to say this, but elements of Bill C-51, if passed, must be disobeyed. By whom? By our courts. And I expect that this legislation will set up a major conflict between the executive and the judicial branches of government. It is, I think, a very sad state of affairs when on the 800th anniversary of the signing of the Magna Carta, we are chipping away at this very foundation of our constitutional order.
Thank you very much, Professor Cameron. Now we turn to Professor Craig Forcese, who has been called to the bars of Ontario, New York, and the District of Columbia, and is associate professor at the University of Ottawa. Much of Craig's present research and writing relates to international law, national security, human rights, and democratic accountability. He is the author of National Security Law, Canadian Practice in International Perspective, a treatise on national security law. Craig's research and policy focus in other writings has included a particular emphasis on anti-terrorism and human rights and on government national security secrecy law. He is co-editor with Nicole LaViolette of the Human Rights of Anti-Terrorism, a collection of papers discussing the Ottawa principles on anti-terrorism and human rights. He has also written and served as an expert witness at the Arar Commission on diplomatic protection of Canadian nationals overseas in the anti-terrorism context, and has authored articles on the use of military force in anti-terrorism and oversight and review of intelligence agencies. So please join me in welcoming, via Skype, Professor Craig Forcese. Welcome, Craig.
So thanks very much. Let me first do a sound check. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can. Yeah. Very good.
Okay. So just be aware there's a bit of a lag between when I speak and when you hear me, and vice versa. Also be aware that every once in a while there's a bit of a dropout in the sound, and so if I start to sound like a bit of a robot, maybe someone in that front row just to the left of the table where my camera is aimed can just wave a little bit and I will pause and hopefully the sound will then modulate. So I've been asked to address a couple of aspects of C-51. I'm actually happy also, perhaps in the question and answer, to talk a little bit about the process associated with C-51, not least the parliamentary process, which, as Professor Cameron was indicating, has been quite concerning in terms of its depth and tone. But my focus in my brief remarks at the outset will be on two aspects of Bill C-51. And so the first of those will be just a follow-up on Professor Cameron's comments about the CSIS powers. I'm getting some static. Can people still hear me?
Yeah, okay. We can hear you.
And the second aspect will be the new speech crime. So just in follow-up in terms of the new CSIS powers, as Professor Cameron noted, this is an extraordinary development in terms of the mandate of the service. The service for the last 30 years has been a security intelligence operation. That is, it's tasked with collecting information and analyzing information in relation to so-called threats to the security of Canada. In the aftermath of 9/11, that mandate was maintained, and it's only now in this new environment where there's a preoccupation with foreign fighting and the lone wolf terrorism phenomena that the government has decided that we need what it calls disruption powers. The government has also claimed that disruption powers are a common feature that's possessed by services in allied jurisdictions. That claim actually overstates reality, as I've discovered by canvassing those foreign jurisdictions. And in large measure, the powers that are proposed for CSIS are a brand new adventure, not just for Canada, but in large measure, a brand new venture for other like-minded and similarly situated democratic societies. And the reason for that is that the CSIS powers, in terms of these new measures, are incredibly broad. And so the government, in articulating the justification for these powers, has said, we want CSIS to be able to talk to families of radicalizing children, or there may be circumstances where CSIS may need to swap out chemicals in a potential a bomb or other munition. The problem is that they've crafted a set of powers for CSIS that go well beyond that, and whose only outer limit, as Professor Cameron noted, is no obstruct justice, no bodily harm, and no violation of sexual integrity. And so the gap between the government's stated objectives and the outer limit of the CSIS power leaves much to imagination. And so, for instance, detention is not precluded, and especially detention overseas where the charter would not reach. And so of concern is the prospect that we might be inviting our security service to engage in practices that for other security services have often proven problematic. Professor Cameron also talked about the warrant proceeding, and I don't know that I have much to add to what he said about the constitutional novelty of the warrant proceeding. It is a dramatic departure from what has gone before. The government has in part defended it when it's managed to articulate a defense by analogy to search warrants, but search warrants are very different. When a judge issues a search warrant, the judge is actually ensuring that the Constitution is complied with. Why? Because it's the warrant that clothes the government with authority that prevents the search from being a breach of the protections against search and seizure in the Charter. We don't have the same tradition of warrants that are deployed in other circumstances for other Charter rights. There is no concept of a warrant for cruel and unusual treatment, or a warrant for prohibiting a Canadian from returning to Canada, or a warrant that allows the government to constrain free speech. There is simply no precedent for that. I could say a lot more about the CSIS powers, but I'm going to reserve that for our conversation in the question and answer phase. What I'd like to talk about this very briefly is the new speech crime. And so the government is proposing a new speech crime for those forms of communication, and it's a very broadly constructed concept of communication, those forms of communication that advocate or promote terrorism offenses in general, in circumstances where the speaker may induce someone who hears them to engage then in a terrorist offense. The problem, of course, with the language of this new speech offense is that it's unique. It's a new set of terms that have been cobbled together in this new context, and so the reach is quite uncertain. Professor Roach and I spent 10,000 words trying to actually understand the scope of this offense, and we ultimately concluded that we couldn't. But we had good reason to suspect that it would be overbroad in terms of its reach and unconstitutional, because it would reach speech far removed from either actual violence or threats of violence. And so, in other words, it touches speech that is well within the orbit of what's protected speech under the Canadian Charter. More than that, and I want to talk about another aspect of C-51. C-51 can be critiqued not just from a civil liberties rights perspective, but also from a security perspective. So every aspect of C-51 runs the risk not only of trenching deeply on rights, but also runs the risk of being counterproductive from a security perspective. And here, the concerns I have, and they're not just my concerns, is that this new speech crime will reach conduct of a sort that is really at play in the very important counter-violent extremism programs that this country is now establishing. In other words, the speech crime risks creating a speech chill, which will deter participation in counter-violent extremism programs. Those programs depend on a frank exchange of views, and they are conducted in what the RCMP calls pre-criminal space. That is, a zone where the person can speak freely without the prospect that they're going to have to be, the Mountie's going to have to turn around and arrest them. Well, the problem is that as soon as a person now begins to echo, say, the full Al-Qaeda worldview in a discussion where there's some prospect that, say, someone hearing this may then turn around and give money to a terrorist group, they've now entered the realm of criminal space and are subject to prosecution. And so anyone giving legal advice to a person who might consider participating in these programs would probably say it's not worth the risk, don't do it. And so in the absence of willing participation in counter-violent extremism programs, those programs may be less successful than they otherwise would. And that's of great concern, because the research suggests that the problem of violent extremism is not one that we will ever prosecute and incarcerate our way out of. It's dependent on successful counter violent extremism programs. And so those are programs that deserve our full attention and full support. And the risk is that C-51 in this area and in so many other areas runs counter and is policy incoherent with some of our more successful anti-terror tools. And so I want to end there, and I'm happy to address many of the other issues that arise in the question and answer period.
Thank you very much, Professor. So now we will turn the floor over to Micheal Vonn, who is a lawyer and the policy director of the BC Civil Liberties Association. She's been an adjunct professor at the UBC Faculty of Law and the UBC School of Library, Archival, and Information Studies, where she has taught civil liberties and information ethics. She's a frequent speaker and media commentator on a range of civil liberties issues, including policing, surveillance, and freedom of expression. She is an advisory board member of Privacy International. Please join me in welcoming Micheal Vonn.
Oh gosh, everybody's done such a good job of the Summarisen Proust task of trying to get this massive omnibus bill into a few pieces that we can discuss. I'm going to be talking about the Security of Canada Information Sharing Act and the no-fly provisions. Those are my two areas to cover. So the Information Sharing Act, the premise is to encourage and facilitate information sharing to protect Canada against activities that undermine the security of Canada. Now this is new language in the security legislative field. I'm going to echo again many times the sense of the novelty, the newness. We don't actually know in the limbo of ever-decreasing standards where exactly this line is to be drawn. This is language that Craig and Kent have discussed as wildly overbroad and unprecedented in Canadian law, this notion of what undermines, not threatens, undermines the security of Canada. The information disclosures authorized by this proposed act relate to these activities, and these activities, in terms of the list as they're discussed, are so far removed from what we understand to be terrorism that they include, security of Canada involves the economic and financial stability of Canada. It can involve interference with critical infrastructure and indeed the administration of justice. So this is a section of the bill that has been receiving a lot of attention in the media and at committee. The Information Sharing Act would facilitate disclosures among a number of federal government institutions, including the Canada Revenue Agency, Health Canada, and Veterans Affairs, and then further disclosures onto an unlimited number of people, including the private sector and foreign governments. But this is not, according to the government, open season on critics and protesters, says the government, because this section expressly provides that activities in question, the security of Canada undermining activities, do not include lawful advocacy, protest, dissent, and artistic expression. Now, this has caused a great deal of discussion, as I say, all manner of discussion with respect to the fact that unlawful does not mean criminal. So, as many people have already pointed out, quite appropriately, your demonstration is unlawful merely for failing to acquire an appropriate permit. Civil disobedience of the kinds employed in almost every significant historical and contemporary movement from the suffragettes to Aboriginal rights, also not likely to be captured by lawful advocacy. And these are very, very important points to make around what could be in the catchment of what undermines the security of Canada. I don't mean to minimize this conversation in the least, but I think it is insufficient. Too little attention, in my view, has been paid to the vast scope of the information sharing purposes. So the fact that information sharing under the Act is authorized for the purposes of detecting, identifying, analyzing, preventing, investigating, or disrupting activities that undermine the security of Canada clearly means, in my view, that fully and unquestionably lawful advocacy and protest information, including personal information, can indeed be gathered and shared. How else, after all, are we to investigate? How else are we to detect? How else are we to prevent, unless we have a wider catchment than what we think we're looking to seize? We already know that CSIS and the RCMP have and continue to monitor nonviolent protests, certainly including First Nations and environmental groups opposed to the Enbridge pipeline, for example. But more tellingly, we know that the Federal Government Operations Center has called on all federal departments to compile information on all protests in the country. Quote, for common situational awareness at the national level related to all hazards of national interest emerging or occurring. So, currently, the federal government takes the view that all lawful assembly requires situational awareness for its potential to burgeon into the hazard of national interest. Now, helpfully, we have some documents provided through Freedom of Information that give us an idea of what is being captured under the GOC's mandate. And these include the monitoring of potentially hazardous events of national interest, such as, and I'm quoting here, a healing dance in Kenora, Ontario, a prayer ceremony in Edmonton, and an Idle No More taco fundraiser raffle and jam session, all directly out of the documents. So once again, I'm going to put in my pitch here for us not to get overly focused on this question of whether lawful excludes lawful protests and how that fits in and what pieces. The fact that information disclosed is supposed to be in relation to security undermining activities that exclude lawful advocacy is not quite a red herring. It just detracts us from the purposes, which are so broad because they include investigating, deterring, and preventing, that they clearly sweep information into that catchment that will include lawful acts, advocacy, precisely as we are seeing operationalized right now through the GOC. So what are the potential harms of indiscriminate information disclosures that would be authorized under C-51? Again, as Kent and Craig have noted, improperly shared information may result in rumors and innuendo being reconceived as fact and used to justify actions of a sometimes very troubling sort. This can lead to, and has led to in the past, damaged reputations, loss of employment, being barred from flying or crossing a border, and even, as we know from two public inquiries in Canada, being kidnapped and rendered to torture in foreign countries. In the face of the dangers of information sharing that were stressed in the Arar inquiry, here are the proposals contained by the government in Bill C-51. This is what they propose to do about those dangers. One, make the situation infinitely worse by adding hugely to the stockpile of dangerous information sharing practices. Two, failing to address the inquiry's urgent call for oversight and controls to ensure that information is screened for reliability, relevance, and accuracy. And third, legislating a provision that protects the government from civil liability for information sharing so that anyone who found themselves faced with the terrible ordeal of Mr. Micheal Vonn could no longer sue the Canadian government for complicity in rendering him to torture. See, if you will, the provisions for qualified immunity against civil suits arising from good faith information sharing. So that's a little quick bit about the Security of Canada Information Sharing Act, and now I'll move very quickly to say a couple of things about the new no-fly provisions. No-fly provisions in general we have had since 2007, the Passenger Protect Program in Canada. As a threshold matter, the Civil Liberties Association has, along with many other people, including the Privacy Commissioner of Canada, asked for any evidence anywhere to demonstrate the efficacy of no-fly regimes, and none has been put forward. Travelers on no-fly lists are deemed too dangerous to fly and yet too harmless to arrest or indeed go anywhere else, including malls, schools, churches, etc. If the aim is to keep suspected terrorists off planes, that can be accomplished under the existing laws. For example, law enforcement officials, if they have enough information to determine that an individual poses a threat to aviation safety or that they are planning to board a plane in order to commit a terrorist offense, they also likely have enough information to lay charges or to seek a reconnaissance order with conditions. Remembering, of course, that conspiracy to commit or attempting to commit terrorism offenses are themselves crimes. So the criminal law already has in existence powers that could be imposed, that would be the equivalent of imposing a travel ban. So while we have found no evidence that no-fly schemes, regimes of the kind that we are about to entrench further and make more Byzantine and more broadly applicable than we have to date, do anything for aviation security. What we do know that no-fly lists have been used for elsewhere and are in fact quite good for is pressuring listed individuals to become informants for security intelligence agencies. This is what we are seeing in the US, for example, and I'm just gonna cite something from the ACLU, the American Civil Liberties Union, about this trend that they're seeing in the US. So they are talking about an American citizen who was allowed to fly out of the United States to visit his family in Yemen. And when he tried to board a flight back to San Francisco, he was denied boarding. Stranded abroad and desperate to return home, he sought help from the US Embassy in Yemen and was asked to submit to an FBI interview. The FBI agents offered to arrange for him to fly back immediately to the United States if he would agree to tell the agents who the bad guys were in Yemen and San Francisco. The agents insisted that he could provide the names of people from his mosque and the San Francisco Yemeni community. The agents said that they would have him arrested and jailed in Yemen if he did not cooperate and that he should think about it. He did, however, not know any bad guys and therefore refused to spy on innocent people in exchange for a flight home. Now, the fact that the law enforcement agents were willing to let him, board a flight if he agreed to spy on his community suggests that he posed little risk to aviation security in the first place. And the fact that they asked him to spy on their behalf suggests that they actually didn't suspect him to be a terrorist either. The fact that he was permitted to leave the United States but not return home unless he agreed to become an informant suggests that such blacklisting isn't really about keeping the skies any safer. I could discuss further the more Kafkaesque elements of how you find out that you are actually on such a list and how you might attempt to get yourself off such a list. But my time is up, so I'm going to leave the rest for questions and leave you with that for now. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Micheal. Now we move on to Professor Margot Young. Margot, are you there?
I hope so. Just let me do a sound check. Can you hear me well?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Great.
Good.
Well, thank you to the organizers of the panel, and I'm pleased to be part of it, albeit from some distance away.
Could I just introduce you before you speak? Would you mind?
Not in the least.
I'll be quick. So Professor Margot Young began her teaching career at the Faculty of Law at the University of Victoria in 1992 after doing graduate work at the University of California, Berkeley in the fields of feminist legal theory and reproductive technologies. Her focus quickly shifted to the areas of constitutional law, in particular equality law and theory and social welfare law. She has continued to teach and research widely in these areas. Professor Young has worked with a number of non-governmental groups on issues of women's economic equality and justice. She has authored alternative NGO reports for Canada's periodic reviews under the United Nations ICESCR, ICCPR, and CDAW committees. Recently, she is co-author of the collection Poverty, Human Rights, Social Citizenship, and Legal Activism, published by UBC Press. Please join me in welcoming her. Take it away.
I seem to be the comic relief on a panel that actually is about something that's not very funny at all. I want to begin by noting two really deep ironies that play out through this discussion and really tie in quite closely to the comments that Max gave at the beginning. The first is that the content of this particular proposed bill really puts at risk that which it purports to be protecting. So it protects something that it then undermines. And the second irony is the process by which we're seeing this bill enacted indeed does great damage to our political and legal system, which is supposedly the justification for the bill in the first place. And I want to reemphasize that the key concept that's imperiled here is the very broad notion of the rule of law. This is a central principle to our democratic system. And it's the idea that state power is to be exercised only in the terms of the law. So it's not a matter of an individual's judgment, the will, the politics, the belief, no matter how wisely or well exercised, that determine the kinds of power and the extent of state power. Rather, the proper enactment of the law, which is part of what our Constitution guarantees, is that it serves as a restraint and a limitation and a definition of the power that the state is able to exercise in our constitutional democracy. And while we've seen evolving notions of the state, which, this idea originally was about the state as the greatest threat to individual liberty, we now understand that in some circumstances, the state actually has a task of fulfilling or realizing individual liberty. But nonetheless, we still hold of primary importance this idea that state power is exercised under the law and in accordance with the law. And for law to effectively function, this definitional role and this limiting role of the otherwise unlimited power the state has, laws have to have certain characteristics. They have to be known, that is, they have to be publicly articulated, they can't be secret, they must be clear and precise. That's another feature of knowability, that we actually know what powers they grant and what they don't. And we have to know really what all of the terms of the power granted or the exercise of state action under a law are. These are key features of the rule of law and of the, and without these key features, we essentially have a state in which potential abuses of power go unchecked or become uncheckable. And actually, Craig used a wonderful metaphor in an interview I heard him do about the slippery slope of the abuse of power and how so easy it is for those with power to start sliding down it as they make sort of a myriad of what seem to be small and inconsequential decisions that snowball into real abuses of power. And what law does, and its limit on powers, what that does is provide the grit, as it were, that stops the slide down this slippery slope that leads to such extreme abuses of power. It stops the slide down the slope into basically tyranny. So I want to go now from this more general conversation about the features that law must have, and that actually our constitution requires laws to have, what these features are, and a couple of other ways that join the sort of litany of problems with this bill, a couple of other ways in which these important guarantees of the rule of law are ignored or purposely undermined. And so I want to talk very briefly about what happens to preventative detention and then a little bit then about what happens to security certificates under Bill C-51. So let me talk first about preventative detention. Preventative detention is an extraordinary power that the state has and that the agents of the state have. This is the detention or imprisonment of an individual who has not necessarily done anything wrong. You can be detained without having committed an offense, without having any charges laid against you, and without any of the attendant due process guarantees and protections that follow if you actually enter through being charged into our criminal justice system. Now, there are reasons that we allow for this kind of preventative detention, and there are lots of provisions for it that have been upheld judicially in the criminal code already existing, but it is nonetheless a serious infringement of individual liberty and a significant exercise of power that the state wields. Now, what Bill C-51 does is change the terms on which preventative detention becomes possible in relation to terrorist activities. And it opens wide the basis on which state agents are able to preventatively detain individuals. Essentially, the language goes from preventative detention being a response to reasonable grounds for thinking that detention is necessary to prevent terrorist activities, to simply having reasonable grounds to believe that such activities might be carried out absent preventative detention. And so, and in other ways as well, we see a kind of blowout, as it were, in a very nondescript way of these extraordinary powers of preventative detention that individual law enforcement officers under Bill C-51 are allowed. As well, the length of time in which an individual can be held in detention is doubled, and various penalties for breach, for example, of being put under recognizance or a peace bond are also increased. So there's a sweeping process then, or sweeping powers that are introduced in relation to preventative detention. It's not clear why they're necessary, but it is clear that they give a large and insufficiently defined scope to the powers of this really extraordinary state response. I want to just mention briefly then as well the notion of security certificate proceedings under the Immigration and Refugee Protection Act, that there is an ability of the government to apply for information not to be kept secret from individuals who are part of a process before a judge with respect to security certificates. And it's just really unclear what that information will be and why it would be before the court in the first place. And we can talk a bit more about this in the question period. But the curtailment of state power and the transparency of the use of state power are both significantly imperiled by the change in this language in the new provisions. I think I'm running out of time, but I want to touch on one other issue that I think we will want to talk about in the question period, and that's the question of oversight and review, both of which are key parts of the legitimacy of state, the exercise of state power. So transparency and accountability are solid precepts on which our system holds state power accountable, or under which it holds it accountable. The reliance on the Security Intelligence Review Committee for review of CSIS activities is simply inadequate. The committee has been well documented to be incapable or not have the capacity in two ways. The first is they're understaffed and they're under-resourced, and the second is that they're spread thinly in terms of what they're able to do currently, and with the expansion of powers that Craig talked about of CSIS, they'll be even more inadequately resourced and able under their mandate to really look at the kind of complex interaction of security activities that will be carried out. The last piece that's important to emphasize is, again, in terms of review, we are one of the few Western democracies that has no legislative review system. So we do not have parliamentary review. That's unusual. Our security partners all have it. It would be easy to set up a special security committee composed of MPs who could review the entire security and intelligence landscape, as it were, take a look at the forest, not merely the trees, and provide us with that kind of democratic accountability for the exercise of these extraordinary powers that are being given to our intelligence folk. Okay, that's it, and I'm going to turn it over to the moderator.
Thank you very much, Margot. Excellent. So now I'd like to invite our final speaker for the evening, Mr. Zool Suleman, to come up and take a seat. Could we also get a glass of water? You can right over there. Yep. So Mr. Zool Suleman is a Canadian immigration and refugee lawyer who has been in practice since 1992. He clerked at the Federal Court of Appeal in Ottawa before establishing his own law firm in Vancouver. He's been a frequent commentator on issues related to migration law and culture. In 2004, he began a national movement to stop racial profiling and worked with Libby Davies and other members of Parliament to enact a private member's bill, Bill C-296, an act to eliminate racial profiling. He has also been active in public policy issues as a former chair and current member of the City of Vancouver, City of Vancouver's Mayor's Working Group on Immigration. In 2011, he served as a consultant and writer for the Dialogues Project, a dialogue between First Nations, urban Aboriginal, and immigrant communities in Vancouver, authoring the project report. He is also the director of the Maru Society, a nonprofit engaged in issues related to migration, art, and race. Currently, he is engaged in a multi-year project exploring issues of Muslim identity in the urban space. His comments are his own and not that of any group or project that he's affiliated with. Mr. Zool Suleman.
Thank you very much. I would like to start by acknowledging that we're on the unceded territories of the Coast Salish peoples, in particular the Musqueam, the Tsleil-Waututh, and the Squamish peoples. I would also like to thank the SFU Institute for the Humanities for inviting me to speak, as well as the sponsors of the event. The title of my talk is The Watchers and the Watched. Who's framing who? In a recent exchange in the House of Commons, Prime Minister Harper was challenged on why he continued to appeal in federal court the ban on the niqab during the citizenship oath ceremony. His response is telling. He stated, and I quote, "These are not the views only of the overwhelming majority of Canadians. They're the views of the overwhelming majority of moderate Muslims." Further, he challenged the leader of the Liberal Party by stating, and I quote, "It is up to the leader of the Liberal Party to explain why he's so far outside that main frame." I find these comments telling in several aspects and wish to speak today to unpack them in my talk about Bill C-51 and how it affects the Muslim community in particular. Unlike the Prime Minister, while being a Muslim myself, I do not claim to speak for all Muslims, moderate or otherwise. I only speak for myself. Let me be clear that there is no one monolithic Islam. There are many interpretations of Islam and many Muslims who practice their faith in differing ways. I would suggest that no one knows what Muslims in Canada actually feel about Bill C-51 and its related pieces of legislation, because there is no one prototypical Muslim who is the bellwether on such issues. In making his comments, I believe that the Prime Minister and by extension his government are engaging in a framing exercise that is divisive, disingenuous, and destructive. It is amazing what some will do in the pursuit of power. In his remarks, the Prime Minister engages in a process where he frames what it is that Canadians want and what Muslims want. It is the framework of us and the other. Us are the rational, law-abiding Canadians who are on a civilizing mission. The values which us embrace are those of democracy, secularism, liberty, and reason. The other, the foreign, the Muslim, embraces tyranny, religion, authority, and violence. Barbarism and chaos will ensue. Order must be imposed. The continued erosion of civil liberties and privacy are the price that must be paid. Let there be no doubt, it will be paid more by the other, the Muslim, than us. Such has been the record of our recent past. I remind you of Meher Arar, Muhammad Majrub, Abdal Ben Hamoud, Muhammad Herkat, Abu Safiya and Abdul Razik, Abdullah Al-Malki, and most recently, Benamir Benata. These are names which we should remember. I would suggest that there are many others we do not know about. These are names that share a common story, but embrace diverse notions of what it is to be Muslim. These are the names that should remind us that our recent past could well be our near future. In his framing of us and the other, the Prime Minister has also created a space of accommodation in which the quote-unquote reasonable Muslim can find comfort. The reasonable Muslim, I would suggest, is an odd and fluid space. It offers safety to some Muslims, but at the cost of the majority deciding what is reasonable. Reasonableness is a moving and unstated terrain. What is reasonable today might be too accommodating in the near future. Hence, not unlike the frog in an ever-heating pot of water, there is a false sense of calm before it becomes too late. This is not conjecture. This has happened before. This is happening again. The reasonable Muslim serves as both sword and shield. The Prime Minister hides behind the reasonable Muslim to defend himself. He thrusts the reasonable Muslim rhetorically in the face of all Muslims and all Canadians. Rhetorically, he states, "See, I have Muslim allies. If they understand, why don't you?" While the Prime Minister frames us and the other in his comments, he also asserts that he's inside the main frame, and I quote, while others are outside. In this, I do not think he's referring to the computers at CSIC or CSEC, but rather that it is he who knows what the dominant narrative is in the complex, overlaid debates around security, privacy, and terrorism. What is this main frame or dominant narrative of which the Prime Minister speaks? I would suggest that it is a narrative that goes back to the coming of the white settler to these shores. It is a narrative that embarked on the eradication of indigenous populations. It is a narrative of whiteness, and it is a narrative that simplifies complex issues, a simplification of expediency and willful blindness. the Prime Minister's narrative is one where Canada civilizes barbarians at home and abroad. It is a narrative in which Canada can exert its power and engage in violence in distant exotic lands. It is a narrative that tries to disconnect the global from the local. I suggest that it is a narrative that is incoherent and does not stand up to close scrutiny. I suggest that it is not close scrutiny which the Prime Minister seeks, but acquiescence. In addition to making simple that which is complex, I think that the Prime Minister is also engaging in a framework of fear. The way to ensure that us and the reasonable Muslim comply with the legislative wishes of this government is to heighten fear and to engage in what is increasingly referred to as dog whistle politics. The veiled Muslim woman becomes the symbol of this fear, and she becomes the focus of the state's coercive powers. It, and I quote, is not the way we do things here. It is, and I quote, rooted in a culture that is anti-women, says the Prime Minister. His always able Lieutenant Jason Kinney starts to explain the government's position by trying to provide a lecture on pre-medieval cultural traditions of Arab tribes, and I quote. Hence the tactics are both shock, the niqab is anti-woman, and awe. Let me explain to all Canadians that we know what we're talking about. The government becomes savior and expert. Such good graces are bestowed upon Muslim women in Canada who need to be saved. That there are over 1,000 missing and murdered Indigenous women in Canada is not a high priority for this government, but Muslim women must be saved at all costs and despite themselves. The nexus of the attack on the niqab and oath-taking at Canadian citizenship ceremonies, I suggest, is not an accident. The citizenship oath-taking ceremony has been described as a, and I quote, public declaration that you're joining the Canadian family, and it must be taken freely and openly. To not do so is, I quote, frankly bizarre, end of quote. The framework is one of family, and to join the family, one must be free and open. It is as if citizenship at once becomes confessional, there are no secrets amongst family, and physically revelatory, let's shed our clothing. The framework of the family appeals to the conservative base, and it plays on our deep-set fears about secrets and the sanctity of our loved ones. In the Harper State family, he is the all-knowing, strong father. Jason Kenney is the stern but jolly uncle. An uncle who will now be more stern than jolly as our defense minister. Those Muslims who challenge this framework are increasingly being marginalized as bad Muslims. Good Muslims take open-faced citizenship oaths and continue to profess their loyalty to the Canadian state at every turn. Whenever there's an atrocity committed in the name of Islam, our media can be sure to find out if good Muslims are denouncing the violence and continuing to be loyal to the Canadian state. The loyalty oath repeatedly is the new normal for Muslims in Canada. This too is not new. Look at the many Canadians who over the past decades have been interned, dispossessed, and denied membership in the family of the Canadian state because of their race, political opinions, ethnicity, and more. Muslim voices are being silenced. There is a chill in our democratic debate. We do not know who are the watchers, but we have some sense of who is being watched. For many Muslim voices, it is a process of self-censorship. Better silence some reason than being labeled a terrorist. If my comments reflect the current government, with regard to the current government, has tried to frame the issues over Bill C-51, and I admit I've engaged in some rhetorical flourishes of my own to make my argument, what is it that we all can do to challenge the government and its narrative? First, I think that we cannot continue to deny the complex intersection of race, gender, religion, culture, history, and power, which are at play. To be simple is too simple. These are complex issues which need complex answers. Discussions like the one which we're having today are very necessary if we are to combat the fear of climate. Yes, Prime Minister, we will and we may need to practice sociology and anthropology and politics and law and religion and much more. Second, we need to build alliances in this fight. Over the last few weeks, it has been astonishing to watch the interests of civil libertarians, privacy advocates, environmentalists, First Nations, and Indigenous groups, women's groups, academics, and many others which have begun to coalesce in opposition to these proposed laws. In this, I find hope and a way forward. I want to conclude by noting the comments of Canadian Jean Vanier, the founder of Laoche, upon winning the 2015 Templeton Prize. He was in the same news pages as the coverage of Bill C-51, and my eyes drifted to his story. Laoche is an international network of communities where the disabled and volunteer caregivers live together and create meaningful communities. He noted, "We live in a world that is rather terrifying. People close ranks and hide behind their factions. There is great insecurity." But he continues, "It is possible for humans to live together as long as you will let down walls that separate you. Let us begin to let those walls down. No more fear. Enough."
So thank you very much, Zool. We now have exactly 40 minutes for Q&A. We have a microphone at the front here, so please step forward if you'd like to ask a question or make a comment. But I would also ask that you be brief and to the point. I imagine there'll be quite a few people who would like to have the floor, and so to accommodate everybody, I think it'd be good if we could stick to this protocol. And could you also address your question either to the panel as a whole or to an individual panelist? I think that would be helpful. So, please.
Thank you very much, and thank you for a nice, excellent supply of speakers. It's one of the best presentations I've heard in quite some time. Question to Mr. Cameron. Would it not be better if we learned not to use the language of those people who wish to do us harm? We talk about conservative. Mr. Harper is not interested in conserving anything of Canada, much less the Constitution. We talk about Bill C-51, but Bill implies legislative legitimacy. If you look at what Harper is doing, he is declaring war on his own people. We are essentially at war. And if we do not take, if we do not use the language, if we use the language of the people who are committing the war against us, we are laboring under the delusion that everything will be okay if we just play by the rules. We should not play by the rules.
Okay, do we have a specific question?
Yes. Thank you. I don't mind. Would you suggest that it might be more useful to demand that the Governor General remove Stephen Harper as he is empowered to do, and put an end to this nightmare once and for all, that if we should find a way to circumvent Harper and his dictatorium, maybe we can find some way out of this mess, and finally use the F word to describe Harper, which is fascist?
Okay.
For a minute there, when you said we are at war, I thought that you were actually quoting Harper, because Harper frames politics in terms of us versus them, and we're at war with, you know, jihadists and so forth. I actually think that the way to resist this kind of discourse is to shift it from a frame that is that of friends and enemies, which is a frame that lends itself to fascism, back to a frame of how we find agreement and we learn to live with one another within the context of shared rules, the legitimacy of which we can all accept.
But we have no legitimacy.
Sorry,
no
we have to take the next question. Thank
That's
you.
That's the problem.
Thank you. The next, next speaker, please, or next questioner.
Yeah, my name is Charles Boylan, and I am with a group newly formed to oppose Bill C-51, and we've had very successful pickets outside SkyTrain stations to hand literature to people and actually make them aware. We get a lot of thumbs up. We get a lot of positive response. And so I'd really encourage people to be active, because a lot of our fellow Canadians are not aware of the law, not aware of the significance of it, and we need to arouse them. I think that one of the fertile grounds for Harperism and fascism or whatever is a depoliticized body politic. And I think that this is one of the great dangers that we have to overcome by arousing the people in action. My question has to do with the remaking of the Canadian state. And I'd like to throw the question open to anybody in the panel, but it does seem to me that the whole notion of public authority is being replaced by the practice of private authority. I want to give one tiny anecdote of that. This afternoon at 3 o'clock, I stood with a Heiltsuk Nation at Jim Pattison's fish place, because the Department of Fisheries, without following any rule of law or any of the court's decisions about the necessity to consult natives on fishing issues, simply allowed Jim Pattison's fish boat to go and scoop 50 tons of herring in a very threatened fishery. So it seems to me that really what we're witnessing here, and there can be many, many other examples of this at a much more serious level, you could say, that the state agencies no longer appeal or reflect a public authority, but merely the dictate of whatever corporation. It's the same with the RCMP guy phoning the professor from SFU and saying, you know, the security guy calls the RCMP and says, get that guy's ass in, you know, place, right? And so our state agency is directly responding to a private interest. And it seems to me that is a real change in the Canadian. There's not even a pretense of public authority.
Okay,
and I'd like you to respond.
Let's throw that
to
open
that.
To
Thank
the
you.
Panel as a whole. So who'd like to respond? The question of the remaking of the state, the eclipse of public private authority.
Big question. Is this my light?
I believe so.
All I wanted, I guess I could say to that is, yes, I think if you looked at the last 20-odd years of what's been going on in our democracy, there have been further and further incursions of sort of the private into the realm of the public. So I can't speak to the specific examples that you're raising, but certainly in clients that I've represented, I've seen some rather odd things where private interests have called upon the state to do things to my clients that I find rather shocking. So I think it happens. I think it's there. And I think it's probably getting worse. And it's probably getting less documented.
So, can I,
Margot, go ahead.
I just wanted to ask, do we think it's actually getting worse? Or did we reach a time where we were able to articulate what was wrong with it? And we're now moving away from that articulation. So we do have moments throughout Canadian history in which power has been exercised by premiers or other political officials or agents in ways that are clearly unconstitutional and clearly personal or political, not legal. But we've done to some extent, we've been able to articulate why these were problems at the time and to talk more explicitly about the notions of accountability and transparency of power. And what I think is remarkable is that it's as if we're, I don't want to say forgetting those lessons, but we've suddenly got people in power whose ideology is such that those are not lessons they wish to follow. So I don't know if it's worse now than it's ever been, but it's as if a kind of awareness of these problems is being lost or shuffled under the carpet.
Okay, thank you, Margot. Anyone else? Craig, also feel free to jump in, but any others? Okay, we'll move on to the next question.
Sure. First, I just want to say a big thank you to all of our speakers. I think that our academics and legal experts in Canada have really risen to this challenge of informing the public of this insane legislation. So thank you to all of you. My question is about the kinetic powers that this proposes to grant to CSIS. Given that their mandate is very covert and surreptitious, their preventative arrest, for example, is essentially some sort of state-sanctioned forcible confinement. when you're arrested by the RCMP, for example, that's public. Your family members can be contacted, for example, or you can contact them. Does anyone have any insight into how this is going to actually function?
Craig, do you want to come in on this?
Yes. So, I mean, first of all, no one in the service that I've spoken to or any of the government lawyers who've been working on this have any sense that the objective is to set up a parallel detention regime. And so part of the problem with this bill, I think we have to be careful here. It's not necessarily that there's malevolent intent behind it. I think it's a lot of careless drafting in large measure and a cut and paste job from other provisions and other laws that frankly don't work very well situated in this new context. So really there hasn't been a lot of thought that I can detect as to how some sort of parallel detention regime might work. It's not my concern that the day after this becomes law, and my view is that it will become law, I think it's almost certain given what I saw when I was before the Commons Committee 2 weeks ago, and then on another bill I was in front of the Senate, and the Senate, if anything, I think is going to be inclined to rush this through. So it will become law, but I don't think that we're then going to be talking about a CSIS parallel detention regime. My concern, though, is the overbreadth of the law will mean that 10 years from now or 15 years from now, when the understanding by the framers of this legislation has faded and the culture in CSIS may have shifted, that the law opens the door then to what I suppose we can call creative use without checks and balances. So you're right in suggesting no one's given any thought, and that's the problem.
Anyone else on the panel?
I think, I'm not sure if you meant to say preventative detention, which is one of the pieces, but you will note in what Craig was saying that the powers of disruption could include detention. And you're right, that the sense in which we are moving a whole raft of policing powers into CSIS under the realm of national security, under these special provisions, we are cloaking them in secrecy. Right, we will see national privilege, national security privilege invoked constantly. How any of this, how such interactions are going to affect criminal prosecutions, is something that the Canadian Bar Association has raised. And again, there seems to be very little thought as to, as you say, how to operationalize this and what it will mean on the ground. We don't know, but the idea that detentions could be happening through these new CSIS powers is very true. They're not. They would be also preventative detentions, but they would not be necessarily referred to as such.
Okay, thank you. So again, I'll remind you all. So far, it's been very good. Let's be brief and to the point. We have a number of questioners and so on. Thank you.
Great. Also echo the thanks. My question is, in the climate of fear and within the context of the politics of fear which we're in, what do we say to people who are afraid? Because we can't say things like we already have laws for this, this is an overstretch, because people in the mindset of fear are largely irrational to these kinds of legal and rational arguments of which this, you know, the protest about this bill is based on. So what do I tell my mother who's very afraid of terrorists? That's the question.
For the panel.
I don't know your mother, and I don't have a magic bullet. But yeah. but I will say this: I think there really is something to this notion of we need to talk to people who are afraid. Thank you for mentioning that. And when people say things, and I've heard very plaintive cries, we need more tools. I think what we have to do is avoid what I call the short form. We can't tweet this discussion. We're going to have to talk to people and say, what do you see as the gap? What are you afraid of? What do you think we can't do? Do you know about the powers of the police? Because we can have this discussion, but it's going to be a discussion. And I think that's part of what we need here, is we need a long-formed discussion response to what is essentially fear sloganeering. And it's been very effective, but I don't think we can tweet the antidote. Nothing against tweeting, tweet away. Yeah. But do you know what I mean? In the sense of how we're going to actually, it's not going to be a slogan that's going to get to your mom.
No.
It'll have to be a discussion. And again, I think it should start with, What do you think the gaps are? What tools do you think are missing? Mm. And I think that opens the door. That's my thoughts.
If I could also just say,
yeah.
if I could also say one thing, I would just refer back to Professor Forcese's presentation and refer to the ways in which aspects of this legislation, proposed legislation, seem to be self-undermining. Right, the legislation purports to make us more secure, when in fact it might effectively do the opposite, or certain aspects of it. So I think that's an important discussion.
What I wanted to add to that is I think we need to particularize that question. When you say fear and people are, you know, afraid to speak, who's afraid? I mean, there's fear going on in the mosques. There's fear going on in Muslim activist communities. That's a different fear than perhaps your mother is feeling, to which the part of the answer is, yes, there are terrorists, but not everyone is a terrorist.
Right.
So the question is to contain that fear or look into what that fear is about. But there are different communities that have different fears. There is no one fear that we all have. We have specific fears, and then we have specific privileges that help us to deal with that fear. The kind of privilege that, say, you might have, or I might have, or the panelists might have, is very different than someone who wants to be an imam in a mosque, or a woman who wants to wear the hijab. Those are different kinds of fears, and they don't have the kinds of privileges we might have. So there's kind of fear, and then there's location, and I think that's very important.
Okay, great, thank you.
Great. Thank you. Yes.
Good evening, everyone. Great speeches, thank you very much. I appreciate the information. By ethnicity, I am Kurd. Since British and French, they parceled us out, we haven't slept well. And I really supported left, and I hated guns, and I lost relatives. I went to UN by accident. I could go to Scandinavia or Canada or Australia. I didn't know anything. I chose Canada, and I got here. I have a degree from here, and I got twice I traveled. Once to the United States, the Canadian official asked me so many questions, I never drove back once. I've been here since 1990s. I went to Europe once, and I renewed 3-4 passports. Recently, about 4-5 weeks ago, I had in 2013, I got my passport renewed, simple renewal. 4-5 weeks ago, I thought it was spam. I told the person who called. They left two messages, call us back. No mention which organization, who they are, but the name was Maria with the phone number. And I ignored it. The week after, called back. And then I ignored it. Then somebody called at work. I picked it up. That was the same Maria. I said, I told her, I said, you were spam. Why didn't you say which organization, who you were? She said, we are talking about your passport. In your passport, place of birth, you wrote Kurdistan. I said it was backward village. They gave us 48 hours. It's destroyed by Ayatollahs right on Iraqi border, an Iranian border full of landmine. They moved it a little bit further up, and it doesn't exist. And I still really don't want to hear the village. I haven't lived there. I live in exile. And she was sympathetic, and she said, we have to revoke that passport because Kurdistan is a regional, and we give you a new one. So I quit, and I was busy, and she extended for another 2 weeks. Last Friday, I took it there. And then today, 3:27, somebody called from passport office, didn't leave a message. I called back, and I left a message. I said, did you have any questions? Last Friday, I submitted my application for renewal. They wouldn't give me, they wanted new pictures. They wouldn't give me 10 years from today. They said, we counted from 2013. But I don't know any new things happening. This is my fourth renewal. I spent half of my life in this country. It's like a threat. You feel uncomfortable. You feel paranoid. What the hell they want? They ask me to do whatever they want. I submitted last Friday with her permission. I don't know. And I asked, can I have the old one back? They said, no, you can't. but you can write a letter to them. I was so upset. I just wrote one sentence and I gave it to them. I don't know who they are. So anybody knows what's going on?
It's a very specific case.
I don't know.
Okay, well, thank you for your comment, and I think maybe some specific legal advice would be the best medicine here. So thank you.
Yes.
Okay, I'll try to be short. MTS, my name is MTS Poppet. I'm with SIDD. We're one of the sponsors of tonight's forum. And we're actually having a rally in Surrey on April 4th, Saturday, at the Surrey SkyTrain station where our people live. My question is to you, Dr. Forcese, is you mentioned there's a bill, I think it's Bill C-44, that's currently in the Senate, which kind of goes hand in hand with Bill C-51. Can you maybe allude to that? I guess it's going to pass, but a lot of people don't know about that bill and how it works in tandem with C-51.
Sure. So Bill C-44 was the initial set of amendments to the CSIS Act, and they actually predate the events in October. That is the October terrorist incidents. And in fact, were supposed to be tabled on the very day in which the Parliament buildings were stormed. They were introduced a few days after that, and what they do, broadly speaking, is they extend emphatically the capacity of the service to conduct security intelligence, that is, collect intelligence overseas, and expressly authorize a federal court to enable the service to violate the laws of foreign nations for the purposes of collecting that intelligence. That's one aspect. The other aspect is they extend what's known as informer privilege to CSIS informers that would enable those persons' identity to be held confidential in any subsequent court proceedings. Now, it's less contentious than C-51, but I suppose that's just a relative measure. The concern with C-44 is going to be, I think, in some large measure, whether a federal court is ever going to want to issue a warrant to CSIS, allowing CSIS to violate foreign law. I imagine federal court judges are going to be extremely preoccupied with that possibility, because if there's ever some sort of leak or scandal, that their reputation will be tarred. And so it'll be interesting to see how this works out. It gets more complex very quickly, because there's also a case now in front of the Supreme Court which will address the extent to which CSIS can operate extraterritorially. At least that'll be part of the case. And it stems from an earlier decision from the federal court. So that'll actually be the first Supreme Court case during the post C-44, C-51 environment. And my expectation is the Supreme Court, as is its tendency, will say something in the course of that decision which may have an impact then in how we construe both C-44 and C-51, at least in part.
Thank you very much. Next question, please.
My name is Shana Plowden. I'm at SFU and also at UBC. First of all, Zool, I wanted to thank you for reminding us of the power of reframing what threat means. I think that that's something that's extremely important. And Michael also bringing it very clearly that what's happening right now is that there's a legalization of that which is criminal, and being able to separate out what is legal, what is made legal in that sense. I'm originally from the U.S., and although I've been here for 5.5 years, there's times like these where I just feel very, very American, and all I want to do is do something. And my question is, having seen this gone through before with the Patriot Act in the States, what can be done legislatively? Is it possible to break ranks? Is it possible for MPs to break ranks here? Is there any precedence of where this happened? Or is this a fait accompli until it goes up to the Supreme Court?
Good question. So, you want me to open it up? Go ahead, Craig. Go.
Yes, so as I mentioned, I was in front of the Commons Committee on C-51 2 weeks ago and before the Senate on C-44 yesterday. And I've sort of been in the midst of the maelstrom here in terms of the politics. I feel like I'm sort of in Bush League House of Cards these days in terms of the politics. But I have to say the politics on this issue are best described as primitive. It's been actually very, very difficult because the way that the committee process has worked, as you've probably seen, is that the government MPs are disinclined to hear the views of those opposed to the bill and have actually been using up witness time in terms of the question and answer by reading essentially speaking notes into the record and preventing witnesses actually from addressing questions, which is the usual convention for committees, to the point where there has been essentially an attack on at least one witness and then other circumstances. And I would single out the treatment of Alex Neve, who's the Secretary General of Amnesty International. The man's a member of the Order of Canada. He's been in more war zones than most soldiers and has been fighting for human rights for the better part of his career. Essentially, the Tory MP, after Alex's very eloquent presentation, the Tory MP suggested that Alex knew not what he was saying and then proceeded to read speaking notes into the record and refused to allow Alex an opportunity to respond. I've been before 20 parliamentary committees in my life, and I've never seen anything like what I saw 2 weeks ago. It's very clear that the Tories are running this through Parliament. The only hope, and this is really just the last residual hope, is that on clause by clause, which we anticipate within the week, that the government itself, the political executive, will decide to climb down on a number of unnecessary battles. There's a number of things that they could amend in the bill, which would, I think, limit the sort of debate that we're seeing. So the question is whether the government will climb down or not. And I think that'll be dependent on what their internal polling shows in terms of the whatever popularity this bill has. On Senate, you know, the Senate can often be unpredictable in terms of what it does, but my experience on C-44 yesterday is that they are simply disinterested in the details on these bills, and they see it as their obligation simply to pass these things and let other people fix it later down the path. I mean, the number of conversations that I've had with MPs and senators over the last little while where they've said, well, we don't really care that much about the details of the law. We're just going to do this because that's what Canadians need.
Any other comments?
Sure, just to add to that, I think that it's become increasingly clear that we really have one of the most whipped parliaments in among the advanced democracies. I mean, we have, in particular, of the Westminster system. So if we compare ourselves to New Zealand, Australia, the United Kingdom, the degree of party discipline in our parliament is really quite remarkable. And so I think that's a core problem. It's partly that's one of the things that's reflected in the way in which the committee system is working, the lack of meaningful deliberation and discussion both within the committee and in the plenum of the parliament. And it hasn't always been this way. And so I think we are seeing a gradual erosion of the functioning of our parliamentary democracy. And it's not a formal change in the rules of the game. It's just a kind of a change in the culture. Parliamentary systems have always been prone to becoming elective dictatorships to the degree that the power is concentrated in the hands of the prime minister's office and of the staff around the prime minister, to a lesser degree within the cabinet and the hierarchs within the political party. I think what we are seeing in Canada is really the crystallization of a style of governance, which is highly centralized and is actually quite dysfunctional. So let me just give you an example. I mean, I think part of my sense of what's behind this legislation is really an attempt to bully and to intimidate those members of the public that don't agree with this government's agenda. I mean, I think, for example, the inclusion of critical infrastructure as a potential threat to security, any disruption of critical infrastructure, I think is quite clearly intended. I mean, if you couple it with the recent RCMP report that we saw that singled out perfectly legal, peaceful organizations that are advancing environmental goals as potential sort of anti-petroleum activist extremists. This is quite clearly an attempt to sort of bully and intimidate the public. And the reality is that to get traction on an issue like building a pipeline, you actually need to address a broad range of issues, from federal provincial issues to land title issues, First Nations, financial questions, relationship between companies and communities, and to get that right, to do that kind of thing, requires forms of governance that are not highly concentrated and centralized. It actually requires a capacity for
deliberation that goes from the grassroots level to the national level, capacity to convene premiers, to convene First Nations, to build consensus. And that's really what's not, that's just not happening within our current system of government. And if you compare it with the United States, it's true that American presidentialism is a system that provides multiple veto points, and so there's very public bargaining that goes on, and that enables the public to kind of mobilize around issues in a way that can influence the process that is kind of not really as obviously available to us here. What we do have is public opinion and an election this year, and I think that's the critical thing to focus on, is that we need not only to focus on these kinds of discussions about the problems with this sort of legislation, but to try to build a new political culture in our country that says that the purpose of our Constitution and our deliberative institutions is to provide spaces for meaningful debate and deliberation where we come together as a nation, not with 39% of the vote, I've got the most seats and can do whatever I want, but rather that these are spaces in which we build consensus around a broad vision of what the country is all about. We have to get our parties behind that. So I think and I don't think it's going to come from the parties. Parties, and all of the parties are equally disciplined. I mean, the NDP is just as disciplined, if not more disciplined than the Conservative Party. So if we're going to move toward a system in which we empower ordinary members of Parliament to have more free votes, for example, we're going to have to get not just the Conservative Party to change, but also the Liberals and the NDP.
Okay, great. So Craig, did you want to come in?
So Margot wanted to come in, but I'll go after Margot.
Okay, I just wanted to add to that one of the key elements of deliberative process is making space for dissent. And we see the space for dissent closing down at the committee level, in the level of our elected legislative assembly, and in society generally, in that the concern about dissenting voices is very importantly an animating political feature, I think, of this legislation. I wanted to pick up, however, on the last part of the comment, which pointed in the direction of judicial review of the legislation in terms of its constitutionality. I think we can well expect that there will be judicial pronouncement on this legislation, and I can think we can expect that there will be found to be some constitutional problems with it. But the resort to judicial review is a complex one. It's not easy to get matters before the court, particularly some of the stuff that this statute permits. It's costly, there are questions of standing, and it's just really not the solution, although I think it's an inevitability in relation to this legislation.
Craig?
Samir, just in follow-up, because, of course, my comment was very pessimistic, I want to say that the government is absolutely gobsmacked by the level of public engagement on C-51. Mm-hmm. This was not anticipated. They thought they had a winner, and that initial poll that came out in the aftermath of the bill, which showed that everyone who hadn't read the bill supported it. the latest poll puts, the support was put at 80%+. The latest poll puts it at 45. Now, these polls, I have substantial doubt as to whether they mean anything, but it's very clear that the public is galvanized on a very complex manner, in a way that the government did not expect. And so for those of you who are working on this issue, keep working. Again, those internal polls will make the difference whether the government climbs down or not. And so I don't want to end on the notion that this is a lost battle. I mean, I have to say personally, I'm gearing up for litigation at this point, but that's just my role. The role of the public is to keep their voices loud and firm.
All right, excellent. Zool?
There was just a quick... Just a couple of very brief comments. I think MP Michael Chong was reported today as speaking out from the government ranks that he favors some kind of parliamentary overview committee. He's spoken out before. He's been sanctioned before, so we'll see where this goes. The second thing I would suggest, and this is something Craig's, I think, referring to, if you really want to see something that's very telling about this debate, watch the interchange between the Council for Muslim Canadians, which spoke on the first day, and the amazingly rude and accusatory question by Member of Parliament Diane Ablonsi. Have a look at that interchange, and then you will get some sense of the vitriol that's going on this particular issue. The only Muslim witness by that point in time is savaged by somebody on the Conservative majority of the committee. So have a peek at that. And finally, just in terms of getting this in quickly, there is a dialogue going on. It's called Critical Muslim Voices on Bill C-51, Beyond the First Wave of Protests, Thursday, April 9th at 6:30 here at SFU Harbor Center. So please come on down to hear some more voices, some of the newer voices and what they're talking about. It's going to be 6:30, April 9th here at SFU.
Okay.
Thank you.
Good. So we are in the home stretch. I think we'll try to accommodate the questioners who have been standing there very patiently, but let's be as brief as we can, and we can go maybe a couple of minutes over. Okay? Thank you.
Hi. Thank you guys for doing this. My name is Khalil, and I'm here on behalf of Senator Jaffer. She sends her regrets that she couldn't be here herself. But my question, my personal question, is when we talk about parliamentary oversight, I believe Harper has said that we would rather have the experts look at these issues. What does that mean? Who are the experts? And what are some of the issues with parliamentary oversight on these issues that other nations are having? Are there issues with that, or how is that system working?
Can you want me to do this one?
Yep. Sure.
Yeah.
Okay. So, as was mentioned, Canada is one of the few countries in the democratic world that has no security-cleared parliamentarians performing some sort of review function, either through a parliamentary committee or the participation of parliamentarians on some other review body. The issue for the Prime Minister, and what the Prime Minister is really alluding to, is the model of what's called SIRP, the Security Intelligence Review Committee, which is the longstanding review body for CSIS. In 1984, when that was established, we were ahead of the curve. And so what's happened since then is other nations have caught up, and more than simply catching up in terms of creating institutions like CERC, they've also now embellished that with these parliamentary committees. And so I often look to the model in Australia, where they have an equivalent to CERC, whose remit extends well beyond simply looking at their domestic security intelligence service, but also includes their other intelligence operations, which is a real problem domestically, incidentally. CERC is stovepiped, and so they've said regularly to parliamentarians, we can only follow the thread in CSIS, and once there's a joint operation, we can't go any further, and so parliamentarians, you're on your own, good luck. The Australians have cured that problem, and they've cured that problem by establishing the Inspector General of Security Intelligence, an expert body, and then supplemented with a very robust parliamentary committee. And that parliamentary committee has the effect not only of providing that overarching forest perspective, but more than that, it increases competence in Parliament itself. These parliamentarians are now in a position to understand nuance and have a more sophisticated understanding, it seems to me, of the national security landscape. And I have to say that one of the key problems with this debate is that parliamentarians are completely oblivious when it comes to national security issues. And it's very easy to pull the wool over their eyes. I think that's evident in the way that they have accepted testimony, which is patently unpersuasive, if you know a little bit about the subject matter.
Yeah. Thank you, Craig. I think we can move to the next question.
Actually, I had a quick question. Actually, it's tied into another bill that was passed before Bill C-24, Bill C-23, the Fair Elections Act. And I was wondering, because I know there was a lot of issues with the bill in and of itself at the time, and of course there's an election coming up, and there was a fairly low voter turnout among youth under a majority of people, less than 50%. And one of the questions I had is, how do you believe that Bill C-51 could be used to potentially stifle Canadians' ability to vote?
Does that come into play?
Well, I don't see an obvious connection. I mean,
when it comes to the political opponents of Stephen Harper that are fairly open about it when it comes to participating in protests, whether it's Burnaby Mountain or the recent one against Bill C-51 a couple weeks ago.
A graduate student at UBC, Stuart Prest, has a nice article in the National Post just the other day that talked about the similarities in terms of the response to these two pieces of legislation. So that's one parallel I see, is that they're both examples of really quite dramatic legislative changes that have produced the backlash that has come, interestingly, less from the parties and the formal opposition within Parliament than more from civil society. So I was one of the political scientists who helped put together a letter of objection to the Fair Elections Act that ultimately gathered more than 400 signatures of mainly political scientists across the country. And we were astonished as political scientists to see the willingness of all of our colleagues to speak publicly to object to what we felt was a fundamental change to the nature of our democratic process, and really the critical piece of democracy is that moment where the citizen goes to vote, and how we administer elections is so vital. And so I see a parallel in terms of this legislation being similarly a really quite radical change in the way in which the security architecture functions, and I think it has generated a comparably a strong response from civil society. I see the point that you're making about the chilling effect that this has on speech and dissent and so forth, and I think it's absolutely clear that young people vote in much lower percentages than older people, and that part of the reason for that is that young people are skeptical that change can be made through our electoral institutions. And so everything that's done to diminish our capacity to use our political institutions to address the fundamental challenges that we face collectively as a nation, whether it's climate change or pipelines or whether it's security and terrorism, is going to have, I think, an effect of further discouraging the participation of youth. But I don't see any sort of immediate or direct connection in terms of how elections are actually administered or anything of that sort.
Okay, thank you. So now we have two final questions before we conclude.
When you listed the civil society organizations that are opposed to the Bill C-51, you neglected to mention the trade unions, and I'm afraid it's because we haven't been very loud. So we are hoping to change that and become much louder in the coming days. I'm here actually in Vancouver at a meeting of the Hospital Employees Union, which will be debating a motion tomorrow against Bill C-51. I want to ask, thank you. There are a lot of labor councils and other organizations as well. I want to ask a question with regard to the proximity of the danger should this bill be passed. Professor Forcese talked about, well, it's not likely that it'll happen right away. And I just want to comment on the fact that I work in critical infrastructure. And every worker in this country that contemplates strike action or any other job action is immediately faced with your action will threaten the economic security of Canada. So it's there. It's already there. I also want just one small anecdote. I live in Courtney. We had a demonstration, a rally in 2012 when the NEB, the Enbridge hearings were in Courtney. No one expected it to happen there because we're not on the path of anything. But the banner that we had was our coast, our decision. And it was 2,000 people in a celebration. And the following day, the hearings were supposed to take place in Bella Bella or Bella Coola, I can't remember which. Bella Bella, thank you. They canceled them, and they said that there was danger to the panel. There was had been no violence, no threats, no untoward activity on the behalf of anyone. And when they went into a First Nations community, they canceled it because of the threat. So I see Bill C-51 as basically giving blanket security certificate powers to the government on behalf of the energy monopolies and others to act in the way that they have acted with the security certificates, which you mentioned, but I see this encompassing all of us.
Thank you. So, more of a comment than a question. So, Michael Ma from Quantum.
Thank you, Samir, and thank you, panelists, for a great talk. I've got a question from my colleague. My name is Mike Ma. I teach in the Department of Criminology at Kwantlen Polytechnic University. My colleague, Mike Larson, who some of you might know, couldn't be here today, but he wanted me to ask you a question. He writes, several years ago, journalists and researchers obtained government memos concerning the use of intelligence that may be derived from torture. At the time, the position of the government of Canada appeared to be that intelligence derived from torture might be used in contravention of international law in exceptional circumstances and only where public safety is at stake. So the question from Mike is, do you think that the expanded powers and mandate of CSIS under C-51 could lead to the expanded use of intelligence derived from torture?
Excellent question. Who'd like to take that on?
I can just quickly, yes. The reason I think that is we had a great discussion in my office with my colleagues about what this mystery information that could now be introduced in the security certificates process. Oh dear, the process of security certificates now would provide under C-51 this new category for information that is apparently not available to the person who would be subject to a certificate, can be given to the judge, but is not to be relied upon. So this is useless information that is nevertheless going to be provided. What do we think it is? We think it's information derived from torture, that they're determined to somehow get before a judge anyhow. I don't know what else to guess could be in that category that is so useless that you're not supposed to depend upon it, and yet we're going to put it forward, and we're not going to tell you what it is. That's my guess.
Anyone else?
And when Michael says we're not going to tell you what it is, what she means is the information will not be available to the special advocate who is there in a capacity as a kind of public check, as it were, on what's going on in an otherwise very secret proceeding. And so it's odd. It's information that the judge gets to see but is not to rely on and is really not apparently connected importantly to the basis of the certificate, but can't in any event be revealed to the special advocate, so has no sort of accountability. It's a peculiar thing, and that's a good surmise.
Hmm. Okay.
I would just add that, I mean, if you consider that the provisions of this bill suggest that a judge could authorize illegal activities, but that don't cause death or bodily harm or violate the sexual integrity of an individual. So what does that leave open, right? Isolation, sleep deprivation. The U.S. had this extensive discussion of enhanced interrogation techniques and that effort to sort of avoid using the term torture, but in effect to use forms of cruel and unusual punishment. And really, we recently had a attorney from the U.S. Navy speak at the Vancouver Institute, who argued we should be talking not about torture but of cruelty, right? Really, the law prohibits the use of cruelty, and had lawyers within the U.S. military been doing their job, torture would never have been a possibility because it does violate the U.S. Constitution. Not to mention the fact that we know that information extracted through torture is unreliable, that part of the case, indeed, for the invasion of Iraq that was presented by Colin Powell to the UN was derived from torture and was false. And so you don't, it's unwise to go down the route of opening up the possibility of forms of cruel and inhuman treatment of detainees. Reading the language there, it seems to me that there's plenty of space for all kinds of abuses, and that may or may not be the intention of the authors of the legislation. But I would, this is the door, the Pandora's box that you open up when you start to say we can authorize the use of illegal or charter violating actions by our intelligence officials, provided that they get support from a judge who is supposed to weigh the kind of the illegality of that against the potential benefits. So what? How are we to understand what that means? I mean, presumably that's got to mean, yeah, that this is illegal, and we know it to be illegal. But the information that we can extract is of such value that is worth breaking the law. I mean, that seems to me that's the kind of judgment that we're asking judges to make. And that, frankly, is not part of the rule of law. That's not part of of the way in which our judicial system has operated. And if you don't put a stop to that, the dangers of abuse that flow from it are just inconceivable, I think.
Thank you, Max.
It's the slippery slope without the grit. of law. And moreover, I think it's something the judges are not going to be willing to do in some way.
Okay. Thank you, Margot. I would like now, just at the conclusion of the panel, to ask the panelists if they have any final remarks they'd like to make. We've covered a lot of ground, and I wouldn't want to just end here, but if you do have some final remarks, please keep them as concise as possible, and then we'll come to an end. And indeed, you don't have to make remarks, but if you have some things to say, please feel free.
No, I'm good for passing.
No? Craig or Margot, any final last words as we conclude?
No, I pass.
No, just thanks. Thanks for to everyone for their interest.
Yeah. Well, thank you very much. Stole my thunder a little bit. I wanted to just thank, I'd like to thank everybody for coming. I'd like to thank the panelists first and foremostly for their terrific presentations.